गुड आफ्टरनून सर, राजेश सर। सर वी कैन बिगिन एट 3, वुड दैट बी फाइन?
Good afternoon, ma'am. Chitra madam.
Good afternoon, sir. How are you?
I'm so not very fine. I mean, you are in a paradise.
Now in lockdown, sir. Since August 11.
Yes. Complete lockdown, na?
Complete lockdown till yesterday. But today we received the movement card with some restriction within the zone and the timing also. Okay, within that time, we can go for shopping for essentials.
Okay. That's the case. But normal activities?
Normal activities suspended. It's not there.
And but is now, there any case in that zone, in Trashigang zone?
Trashigang, nothing. Not so far.
Nothing. Mm. Oh, that's
good, no?
I mean,
there were rumors until longer, but not till here.
Yes. Actually, here in Banaras, we have, number of cases, and every day the number increases around 180. 190 and the mortality rate is like, not ratio wise, I'm not sure what's the ratio, but yes, 3 to 4 people are losing their lives on a daily basis. But still there is no fear here.
Now there is a steady rise.
So we don't know what will happen, and in fact yesterday evening we were apprehensive because even my eldest brother, second number brother, who is staying with me, he was also showing some symptoms. So we are not taking precaution here at my home also. We don't know, let's see. Yes.
Now so, this week online exams Dr. are going Poonima, on for first semester there?
Yes,
sir, I'm there. Yes,
in YCC. Okay.
Yeah. So, sir, I'm there. Our speaker is also on. nice to meet you, ma'am.
Yeah, yes, same yes, here, ma'am.
Though it's in online mode, but it's nice to meet you.
That became a good chance to meet you.
Yes.
So Dr. Poonima is my senior colleague in Vasant Kanya Mahavidyalaya.
This is Sarah's way of saying that I don't know what to say to it.
No.
You always make me speechless.
I'm
junior most in the department.
Around 7 to 8 years. You have worked around 9 years, na? You have worked for 9 years in Vasant Kanya Mahavidyalaya.
Five and a half, to be precise.
Okay.
So I think ma'am is around, many participants are around. If we can begin, if you allow.
Yes.
If ma'am is comfortable, she is set, all yes, set, sure. Then we can begin.
Sure. Dr. Yogesh Dubey is also trying to join, but due to some network issues, he just called me. So let's wait for 2-3 minutes.
All right, sir. We can wait.
Redirector, sir. English. I think he has joined. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yogesh, are you there? Dr. Yogesh?
Yeah, Rajesh, I'm there. Thank you for waiting.
Okay. Yeah. Yes. Good. And so, okay. So, what do you say, Dr. Yogesh? Should we begin or should we wait for 2-3 more minutes?
We can. For 5 more minutes, I think we can.
Yes, let other participants also join because only 18 participants have joined.
Yeah.
So we can wait for another 5 minutes.
and with the consent of the speaker as well. The speaker.
Yes.
Yeah, sure, sir. No problem at all.
Yes, yeah, speaker.
So, Dr. Yogesh. Dr. Yogesh?
Yes, I think we can. Yeah.
Yes, yes, yes. Please, huh? Because people can join, in that good process. Yes, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. I, Dr. Purnima, Assistant Professor, Department of English, Vasant Kanya Mahavidyalaya, welcome you all to day 5 of the 6-day lecture series organized by English for Nation and Vasant Kanya Mahavidyalaya. Today we have Dr. Chitra S., who is a faculty member in Yonphula Centenary College, Royal University of Bhutan, as our guest speaker. And she is going to present her topic, COVID-19 and gender. Next in order, I would like to call upon Dr. Rajesh Verma from Department of English, Vasant Kanya Mahavidyalaya, to formally welcome our guests. Sir, please.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Purnima. And it's indeed a great privilege, and we are honored that today we have Dr. S. Chitra with us as an esteemed speaker. And with her presence here, this lecture has become now international lecture series. Thank you, ma'am, for that. You accepted our invitation to speak. We know that you are quite busy with some of the things. Still, you accepted our invitation. We are indeed honored for that. And let me take this opportunity to introduce and to say something about the speaker, though it would be short indeed, as she has vast experiences, but still I will just summarize here some of her achievements. Dr. S. Chitra, though she is an assistant professor, because there the rank in the education system is quite different from Indian educational system, but she has a broad teaching experience around 15 years by that, since she is already the professor. So since they have a different structure, so we will call it as assistant professor in English, and she's serving at Yonphula Centenary College. Yonphula Centenary College was the first institute to offer MA in English in Bhutan. I was also fortunate to be part of that college, and we too have worked together. Now, she is not only teaching there as a faculty member, but also she is the head of the department, and under her YCC is progressing a lot. She's a kind of all-rounder. She's supervising thesis, she's supervising research scholars, and then she's the program leader, and then she's also attending seminars, conferences, and at the same time she's also preparing curriculum, and she has some projects also. She has already taught in Chennai, that is one college affiliated to University of Madras, and then as a senior lecturer in the Department of Humanities at University Chennai. Her areas of interest include cultural studies, contemporary literature, post-colonial studies, European literature, women's studies, and she has research projects in the field of Bhutanese folklore. And she has also conducted action research on students' English language proficiency. And she has also recently done some assessment survey of teaching learning during COVID crisis. She is also an IELTS trainer and has completed the teaching knowledge test certified by the University of Cambridge. She has published over 30 research articles in book chapters, journals, conference volumes, and she has presented papers in more than 50 international and national conferences. She had been the overseas examiner of her doctoral thesis and a member of different journals as well as academic boards. And she has also spoken as keynote. She has delivered speeches as keynote in several workshops and in some of the webinars recently organized in some of the reputed universities in India. So we welcome you, ma'am, and we hope that in the next 1 hour or whatever your time frame is, we will listen some kind of good things, and we hope that you will share with us some of the Bhutanese experiences also.
Yeah, sure,
so,
sir.
Thank you very much, and over to you, ma'am. Over to you, ma'am.
So thank you, Dr. Rajesh, for your warm welcome and kind words. Rajesh had been, it's a pleasant working with him, and he had been always extending invitation to come to Varanasi, but this situation has made it troublesome. But still, I could meet many of your colleagues and your department through this program. It's a welcome transformation, I should say. Hello, Professor Beena. Glad to meet you as head of the Department of English, Vasant Kanya Mahavidyalaya. And my greetings to all the faculty members of this college from Bhutan. And a special thanks to Dr. Yogesh Dubey, Director, English for Nation, for having me in this program. Thank you, sir. And I'm glad to stay connected with University of Delhi too, because I fondly recall the interview that I have attended. I was selected by a panel of faculty members from Delhi University in 2006 when I joined Bhutan. The interview was conducted in University of Delhi, and at that time the college was in affiliation with university. So now I had another chance to get reconnected with the English department of Delhi University. Thank you, sir. I will just take a few minutes to share my slide. Sir, your window comes when I try to share.
So, is there any issue, madam?
My slide is open, but when I try to share, your window comes. Uh-huh.
Okay, so why is it so?
The window on the screen that comes.
Chandkant, are you there? Can you just, okay, let me.
Ma'am, is it PPT?
Yes, sir. I'm trying to share it. Okay. From the icon present now. From that icon, I'm sharing. But it shows your screen.
Ma'am, is your PPT open already?
Yeah, it's already
in
open.
Your computer, laptop?
Yes, it's open.
It might take a few minutes. It happens sometimes.
Yes.
So because what is showing on your screen?
My PPT is not showing.
Mm-hmm. So what is coming on the screen?
The screen is coming on a small scale. Your screen is coming on a small scale.
Ma'am, close your PPT once and reopen it.
So Rajesh sir, I have shared you how it is, the picture. Yeah, now I'm getting. Is it visible?
Yes, ma'am.
It's visible.
Okay. Greetings to organizers and participants from Bhutan. So this title, COVID-19 and gender, that I would be delivering today is not a new title. Gender is not a new title, but now this attachment of COVID-19 makes it somewhat intriguing, because I have chosen to approach this topic not from the usual literary representation with which gender stereotype is discussed, but under the framework of COVID-19, by looking at the impact on gender, I'm trying to assess the current situation as the reality representation, how today's reality is. That's the approach and analysis for today. With much that has been spoken and written on gender issues, so this is what I considered as something new that can be discovered. That's the reason for this approach. If gender is considered as a closed chapter or a solved problem, why there are gender-related issues even during public health emergencies with life at stake? That was the first question when I received this topic for this international lecture series. And then as I thought about it, I felt the current pandemic caused by novel coronavirus has in fact renewed the opportunity to look at gender dynamics under a new lens, because pandemic is neither gender blind nor gender neutral. It has different impacts on men and women and renders differential treatment on women. And when crisis strikes, gender inequalities are often exacerbated. Keeping this in mind, some of the issues under discussion, I have chosen these issues under discussion. Before that, David Evans, senior fellow at Center for Global Development, indicated four grave concerns in the time of epidemic, such as sexual health, intimate partner violence, burden of care, and economic crisis. And it's time now to deconstruct the effects by probing through another similar set of issues that I have charted out for this talk: the implications of lockdown on women and girls, the norm-driven division of labor at home and its gender impact, along with the work from home scenario during this downturn and the subsequent recovery. Before moving on, let me briefly take you through this lecture outline. These three issues I have attempted to place broadly under the question, what COVID-19 pandemic tells us about gender, whether equality or inequality, gender issues that comes forth. But what it tells us about gender, this current situation, that's the probing question. Has lockdown and movement restriction, has it really saved women from social ills, or has it exposed them more than ever to abuses and gender-based violence, is the first question. Because issues related to vulnerabilities are not just in the outer world. That's the truth pandemic has exposed. in fact, the truth that we have to face, whether it is hard or difficult truth, we are facing this truth. It is that it is a test. Life itself has become a test. It's a true test. The ground is a true test, is to live. That has become the situation. So that's the reality and that's the test this lockdown has also brought to every individuals as a challenge, because the domestic space has become a breeding ground for issues of vulnerabilities and for painful social realities. And this fact of unease has been exposed in the form of violence, abuse, exploitation, neglect, harassment, and only the truth has been partially revealed so far. And due to the severity of the issue, in many of the forums recently, gender has become the focus, the centering thought to create awareness. And this webinar is a timely intervention. But dear participants, other than certificate, what's the takeaway of this webinar? Where to begin to bring about a change, even if the change is minimal? Here comes the next issue, because by now society could identify at least two channels through which COVID-19 pandemic is likely to accelerate change in social norms and expectations. One is the division of labor in the household. Globally, women spend much more time on housework than men. Among those countries, India has the most unequal gender division of housework. And the other side is on the employers in the work from home scenario, which is based on survey findings. Therefore, these issues are crucial to touch upon. And towards the end, I would also touch on other gender related issues that are coming to the forefront, but we have to wait and see what would be the consequences of it. That will be touched before the conclusion. This is the outline I have designed for today's talk. Taking the first issue into account, domestic violence is something crucial. It's a burning issue, because as per UN reports, before the pandemic, less than 40% of women experienced violence, in fact, reported those crimes or sought help. And here the figure states that less than 40% of women who experienced violence reported it. But during COVID-19, in a number of countries, domestic violence surged upward by 25%. There is an alarming increase in violence in almost most of the countries, and it says many reports and emergency calls had been received and they had been recorded. On that basis, it shows there is an upward movement in the number of cases, and it amounts to 25% increase even in a short span of few months in 2020. And if we take the pre-corona period in India, National Family Health Survey 4 states every third of married women suffer from spousal, physical, sexual, and emotional violence. This being the case, amid coronavirus pandemic, harassment, however, has escalated behind closed doors, and pandemic is driving a sharp spike in domestic violence, compounded by income stress. There is the highest financial stress, financial risk and financial stress, that economic insecurity and financial insecurity in families had been the major compounding factor. And other factors that accompanies the income stress are health and security stress, along with movement restriction, crowded homes, that is, the space, constrained space, and also reduced peer support during lockdown especially. I call a mental health helpline calls the current situation. It describes the current situation as a brewing pot. That's how this corona period, the lockdown period, has been described. Domestic violence has been brewing in the domestic space. The space is no longer secure as it is felt to be. It's not safe because frustrated, unemployed, and struggling to access tobacco and alcohol, several men are unleashing their anger through physical, verbal, and sexual assault. As a result, the surge of violence is affecting millions of women of all classes, not only in India, but across the world. That's the reason I have started with the UN report and what it states in the before scenario. But currently it states in the number of countries, the situation is same and the violence is surging upward in Western countries also. And some of the compounding factors I have mentioned. So this clearly states during the lockdown, women are likely to face 2 to 3 times more violence as they have nowhere to escape during this period. And being in lockdown, nobody would come in to help. So that aggravated the disparities and the scene became more worse. The issues of vulnerability increased and aggravated. And it shows the pre-existing gender-based susceptibilities are also shown through this scenes. And here I have taken two different realities. On the surface, they look different, but the underlying results are same. I have chosen two locations with which I am familiar. One is the state Tamil Nadu, where I hail from, and the other place is Bhutan. These are the two realities I have chosen. In April 2020, lockdown, national lockdown is imposed in India and in Tamil Nadu. In this state also, there is complete lockdown in April 2020. And during this month, a report in New Indian Express states that Women's Helpline received only 1/3 of calls, which is very less compared on domestic abuse. They received only 1/3 of calls on domestic abuse compared to the pre-lockdown period or compared to the previous number of calls that they receive in other circumstances. That clearly shows the situation is not free from domestic violence even before. But then there is a sudden decline in the number of calls. The reports were less. That's what it states. So what to infer from this news item and from this information? Is there no domestic violence or has it lessened during the lockdown period? What to infer? So I was not knowing how to receive this news. Then let me give you a picture of Bhutan now before going back to Tamil Nadu. Bhutan is a very small country with a population of 7 lakh plus. And the country is also known for a concept known as gross national happiness. Even in a small country, and a country known for happiness, it's not free from domestic violence cases is the truth. And there was no lockdown in Bhutan until July. There was a national lockdown recently imposed this month only from August 11th onward. But from March onward, the crisis, as the world is in crisis, here also the crisis was there and the precautionary measures were taken. And as a result, schools and colleges were closed and online classes were going on since March. This being the case, the National Commission, Bhutan's National Commission for Women and Children records that 47 domestic violence cases were reported to this commission between Jan and April, when the country is undergoing crisis by bringing Bhutanese who were abroad into the country, and they were quarantined and they were checked, and that's how the cases were contained. Even during this crisis period, domestic violence cases were happening, and within this short span of 4 months, 47 domestic violence cases were reported according to National Commission for Women and Children. Now, if this can be compared to the total cases of 2019, that was only 77. The whole year had 77 cases, but in 2020 crisis, within 4 months, the number of cases were 47. Then there was another agency called Renew. This agency is called Respect, Educate, Nurture, and Empower Women. And this agency's latest record, which was published in National Daily known as Kunsal, it states that this agency received 407 domestic violence cases from Jan to July. And now again, if we draw a parallel with the entire cases recorded in this agency in 2019, it is only 118 cases. So this shows that domestic violence cases are alarmingly increasing. It is drastically increasing in a small country like Bhutan. This being the case, is everything so perfect in Tamil Nadu? Are there no cases, or has it reduced drastically? Why there are no quantified figures in Tamil Nadu was the question I tend to raise by this data between one state and between the state of Tamil Nadu and Bhutan. Obviously, it is not that there is no domestic violence in Tamil Nadu, but one prominent reason for less number of figures getting registered could be confined in a small space with the abuser and with children. Women might not have reported, so there might be secrecy. There was no secrecy to call the hotline. That might be one of the reason that we could assume. But then, according to this New Indian Express and the organization known as Pragya, which works on gender issues, in their report, they have stated, apart from this obvious reason that there is no secrecy to place the call in hotline, that could be the obvious reason. But other than that, one another disturbing reason that they have recorded in their study is that more women in Tamil Nadu have normalized domestic violence, meaning that they accept it. They have normalized it to a great extent, and as a result, there are less figures that are being recorded in the survey. And for this, the organization cites the previous incident of Chennai floods during 2015, and even then, the number of cases of domestic abuse were very less during the crisis times. It says because it is not reported then. But later, when a survey was conducted about the situation, things were different. So that's why I told you it is a superficial reality. But it is not that the crime rate has gone down. The abuses are less. It is surging upward and it is increasing. But then due to other reasons, it's not being recorded, and some of the agencies do not receive calls. And this is considered to be certain differences in reality. So at the end of the session, I would like to hear about it from the participants too, their own side of it. How do they see it? And what are the other realities that are present? Here, I'm restricting the reality between these two scenes in the interest of time. Now to move on, COVID-19 is also shifting other household dynamics. And the claim that I make here is, it is women who bear the large share of domestic responsibilities. That is to say, during lockdown, domestic responsibilities have ballooned for women, with all the members staying at home and children away from schools, with the closure of schools. The amount of work and the amount of responsibilities have ballooned for women. And norms and practices are also such that in many cases, it is women who pick up large share of the chores and cares, and the predominant social norms and the existing domestic structure of the Indian family puts the responsibility squarely on the shoulders of women to run the household, which includes the obligations of attending and caring for each of the family member. They need to be personally attended to, caring, to be cared for each of them, to meet out their requirements and the needs, and also carrying out the daily household chores in the absence of domestic help and domestic help during lockdown times. Here, the Organization of Economic Cooperation and Development states, an Indian woman does nearly 6 hours of unpaid care work each day in comparison to an Indian male who barely gives 51.8 minutes to such tasks. So these are the, this is the data recorded in the pre-COVID period. It says 6 hours of unpaid care work for women, and that is made in comparison to male who gives only 51.8 minutes, not even hours, 51.8 minutes to such tasks, that is chores and cares. But with the new emerging reality and the situation, with the restriction on movement, closure of schools, obviously there is an increased childcare need. Childcare need has become higher. And worldwide, more than 1.5 billion children are out of school during this pandemic, which has dramatically increased the need for childcare. And this situation, we can understand, has a particular impact, a large impact on women whose care work has doubled. It has multiplied. That's why I used the word ballooned. It has, it's manifold, because it includes homeschooling, attending the sick and elderly during the crisis, and also on top of it, work from home scenario, and cleaning is another form of essential work to combat the virus. That also multiplies the domestic work on women. And then with every member of the family at home, the burden of household work and the care work is bound to fall more heavily on women, is the same. But here, let me quickly add the other side of the picture too. So during this lockdown, with minimal, with no outside work, nothing to go out, all of them are staying indoors. So it's likely that the current situation may erode the social norms, with men's engagement in childcare responsibilities and household duties. Here the question arises, did men engage themselves in household chores during the lockdown when most homes were deprived of the domestic help and also the couples started working from home? So what's the scene here? I take two survey reports to ease my work here. One is some of the working papers I have consulted, and another one is a paper with some yearly findings, which I have taken into account for this talk. And this is a paper by Ashoka University economist. And this paper has collected data during the first month of the lockdown. Actually, it makes a comparative study by collecting data from nearly 43,000 individuals in December 2013, how they have spent that time. It is a time use data. How they have spent the time in December 2019, that is the pre-lockdown period. And it targets April 2020 in particular, the first month of lockdown. And during the lockdown, is there any change in men's contribution, in their engagement in the household work? That's how these two periods, the pre-lockdown period and during lockdown period, were compared in this survey. And the finding of the survey, it's heartening to know the finding of the survey, because it shows there are some gains for gender parity. It has found the gender gap in household work reduced by roughly 1 hour a day in April, exclusively in the month of April, as men spent more time on domestic work than they had compared to the pre-lockdown period. In December 2019, the average time spent by women on housework was recorded to be 4 hours a day. But then in April 2020, the report says it finds a sharp decline in the gender gap for domestic work, especially in the following states, Himachal Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, and Delhi. But considering the preliminary stage of the findings and given the flux, the state of flux around pandemic and lockdown, it's too early to say these shifts, to say anything about these shifts, because they may be temporary or permanent. So we cannot say whether they are just transitory shifts or will they be permanent shifts. However, given the context of unequal gender norms of the Indian context, which is highly unequal, this shift appears to be promising, and we do expect that such social norms do get eroded. To complement this, another survey conducted by Pink Ladder, a Bangalore-based organization, finds that the current pandemic, it says the same thing about men. It has given an opportunity for men to share the load at home. So it is likely that the pandemic may have slightly altered the lopsided distribution of the division of labor in housework and childcare responsibilities, with men taking primary responsibilities at home as caregivers. But it is true that even these temporal changes are likely to push social norms towards equality. But the exposure and involvement of male to the division of labor, either through learning by doing or through increased attachment and devotion to children, is expected to generate an upward shift in men's participation, with a sizable number taking the household and caregiving requirements for the first time. And it is likely that it may have great impact on gender norms in the coming days. But again, the fact is that perhaps it is the first-hand experience for many men to know the amount of work their spouse put in daily. And increased male help is described by few reports as the silver lining of the lockdown. If it is considered as the silver lining, don't you think it is the normal share of work at home? It is the share of work. What is so special about it? It is the normal share of work that men are supposed to do at home. Because till today, there are also men who continue to get most of the help from their spouse without acknowledging the fact that their partner is also equally aging with them. So without acknowledging the fact, help is expected from the spouse, then from daughters and sons, and from other family members too. So the situation might not have changed few men, but largely it has brought about a change is considered as a good sign towards gender equality. And how can we miss some of the jokes that were circulated in the media and in the forum, social networking sites during this COVID time, that these were COVID-19 male jokes. Since they are now engaged in domestic work, the joke says morning with Microsoft Excel and evening with Surf Excel. It looks very rhythmic, but this had been the lifestyle of working women for so long that they had been juggling between caregiving responsibilities at home and also performing in the workplace. But largely their contribution goes invisible and unaccountable too. Now let me take you through the care activities data survey done by European Union. It is a time use data done for 2019 in gender domain. So this also clearly shows the disparity that caring for and educating the children, grandchildren, elderly, so the responsibilities go on. After educating children, women have to tend and attend to grandchildren, then other elderly members and in-laws in the family or people with disabilities every day. And here, if you see the participation of men and women in this domestic arena, it is women who are doing more. So the caring responsibilities usually falls heavily on women, not only in the Indian context, but in the European Union time use data also says the same. It usually falls on women. This is the same in the situation before COVID-19, before the outbreak. So women in European Union spent nearly 13 hours more than men on unpaid care work. And if you look at the next one, doing cooking or housework every day, again, it is divided between women and men for gender. Overall, 79% of women cook and do housework daily compared to only 34% of men. So the burden of care, you can see how disproportionate it is. And it has deepening effects during the crisis. This has just deepened further during the crisis in some cases. So in the new normal, but in the previous slide, we have also seen the silver lining. Okay. So in the new normal, if more men pick the share of work at home, it is likely that gender stereotypes and traditional gender roles may get dismantled. If not, then the double burden syndrome of women will have deepening effects. So these are the two sides of the current situation. Now I would like to draw the attention of the audience to a famous French cartoonist, Emma, who brilliantly explains the mental load that woman carries. It's always invisible, but then it has a deepening mental impact on women, which is so tiring. So that's what these cartoons show. And this comic is titled, You Should Have Asked. That's the title of this comic. It starts like a story. An overworked mom comes back from office and she has to cook and tend children, and also she has to organize a dinner party that evening. And she is overstressed already, and there are more to be done at home. So eventually things get out of hand, and she attempts to handle everything by herself. Then her husband says, he would have helped out if she had only asked him to. So that's the response of the husband. So the comic goes on to explain that husbands shouldn't have to be asked to step up. Why should they be asked to step up, come and help? Why should they be asked? It's also their duty to come and help when there is a party at home, or when your wife is overstressed and when she comes back home. Both male and female, husband and wife, they have to come together to share the domestic responsibilities at home. But this question makes things meaningless. You should have asked. That's how ironically it's titled. So it is not women's sole responsibility for directing men. Directing men is becomes another responsibility for women. So it is not their responsibility to direct them and plan everything by themselves. So this explains, you didn't do the dishes. Well, you never asked. So that's the simple explanation. And a woman has to organize everything. And in that organization, which work to assign for male also falls. Then that also becomes a mental load, an additional load. So this multitasking and mental load for women is really tasking. It's really overstretching them beyond their limits. Though capabilities are not questioned, but it's stretching beyond their limits. So these are some of the other pictures for our observation. How the mental load that is almost completely, it is borne by women in almost all the families. And it's this mental load is something permanent and it exhausts one more. Thinking and planning exhaust more than doing itself. And this exhaustion is so invisible that it can physically and psychologically, it can affect, it can have multiple implications on the health of women. So look at the picture on the other side. Man can also do the same thing, child care requirements and household duties, and that will ease the burden and the work, the care work, and it can be done with greater enjoyment and happiness as shown in the picture below. So this, if not, this is the beautiful picture, but when this is not aligned, then that results in double burden syndrome for women. Again, a survey titled remote working in the sense working from home and its impact on women professionals. This survey is also conducted by conducted during COVID period in April 2020, I guess. This has been carried out among 250 women across the metros, Mumbai, New Delhi, Chennai, Bangalore, across these metros. And it states that women had always been the victims to do the double burden syndrome, where they are expected to double up on the home chores with increased workload from office. And obviously it impacts their mental well-being, though they are stretching themselves. So this increases their burden. And another area that needs attention is some flexible work arrangements. That's more that's the requirement now. Because for the first time, work from home options are currently being adopted on a large scale in India. How was this perceived? Again, the survey I have cited earlier from Pink Ladder throws some light on the gendered effects of remote working. So the survey result finds that 67% of managers, here managers are assumed male, 67% of managers fare well, meaning they respect the timings in the work from home situation. But there are 33%. 33% becomes the contesting number in the case of women for rights, in the case of women for their negligence. So 33% of male managers remain insensitive and they are rigid, causing higher stress levels for women. So only if there are some temporary changes in the work schedules with some contribution by men to ease the burden of women, there can be some likely changes. Because even in the work from home scenario, there are many challenges. That's what this survey finding shows. There are rigid work schedules with managerial inflexibility and lack of inclusivity. These are identified as some of the challenges that might again hamper and it doubly stress women. So what could be the likelihood for a new normal? So this is the prevailing situation in the first half of 2020 during COVID-19 crisis. Now, in the recovery stage, what is the likelihood for a new normal? Now, we have seen two observations have been made. One is work from home arrangements and some flexibility in that arrangement, and also men taking their share in domestic work. So how can this help women better, and how will it ease their work and make them to perform better? Because always women are expected to perform better both at workplace and in home. In home also, everything should be perfect, intact, in place. So at least everything should be presentable. So the mental load, responsibility falls on women. So how to tackle this? Are we going to emerge different from the current situation? So what would be the new normal like? If in case the remote working technology, that is the online work, and male participation in chores and cares, if these two combine, then the new normal will benefit women more. And it will benefit both male and female more in combining care and career. They could create a work-life balance. In relative terms, women are likely to gain more because of some added flexibility in their work timings and more contribution from their husbands. So this change to the division of labor between sexes would have long-lasting effects. And pandemic can trigger this shift in gender norms around domestic and care work with long-lasting effects on men's engagement is one likelihood. And again, pandemic also has reminded us the essential contribution that women has made at all levels. Regardless of spheres, it is women who bear most of the responsibilities for holding societies together. At home, at healthcare, and in caring for the elderly, because globally women make up over 70% of health and social service staff, including those working in care institutions as nurses, midwives, community health workers, and also as cleaners, launderers, and caterers. Therefore, recognizing and valuing and supporting women's roles is the COVID lesson. That is to do things differently, because we need women to build back the society better. Now to take a brief look on other gender issues. These are in the stage of reports. So what reports say about women? With more financial insecurity, strain, and food shortage, it's likely that women's nutrition will be affected more than men's. This is said so because taking the Indian context in account, women sacrifice their nutrition for the sake of their children. So their nutrition will ultimately be affected for the sake of the family is one likely situation. And this pattern is also visible across the developing world, from Zimbabwe to Bangladesh, it seems. Then one another issue is about low-income families and lack of digital access for everyone. Each individual in the family may not have a smartphone. They don't have access to gadgets. There might be one smartphone in the family. So this will have consequences in girls' education. With most of the classes going online, in rural parts and in low-income families, boys would be given more preference for girls is another likely situation. And due to financial strain in the family, girls might drop out from schools. And as a result, girls' education might get affected. That is a serious consequence of the post-COVID situation. And due to digital divide between the higher income and the lower income groups, with most of the jobs going online, there might be job market inequalities. And the hardest hit sectors during the COVID being retail, hospitality, and service industry, this might reduce job prospects for women because large share of women's employment are in these sectors. And these sectors are the hardest hit sectors during this crisis. Therefore, the post-COVID-19 situation requires a gender-sensitive planning. Let me conclude with this saying. This became a popular saying during recession since 1990s that never waste a crisis. Use the crisis as an opportunity to build back better. So societies have to rebuild themselves with the help of their visionary policy measures. And these measures need to place gender into their account. It should be a gender-balanced response with gender perspective in all the measures that they take for the upliftment of the society. And governments need to incorporate gender considerations into their response so that this, after this crisis in the post-COVID situation, it should not become just another business as usual, but something unusual. So with this note, let me conclude here and let me say that it is the end. I haven't taken the issue of education largely because the reports are just being in the drafting stage or the papers are in the working stage. And only in the post-COVID situation, as the outcome of online classes, we will know what happened to the rural students and how the education of girls is going to be another challenging phase of the post-COVID era. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for the wonderful presentation. There are certain questions and certain views that people have shared. Fakhri Alam wants to know whether COVID-19 affected the dependent or lower class women in the same manner as the independent or upper class women or differently. I think that you have answered most of the questions, but still, if you would like to add something upon it, ma'am.
Yeah, sure. Thank you, Purnima, for the question. Lower class women are hard hit because they could not reach some of the organizations could not reach out to them to help them, even when the organizations wanted to do. And because of this digital divide within the family, women have less access to the gadgets. And when it comes to girls' education, that's going to be a serious concern in the coming times. It is likely that there might be dropout, girls dropping from schools to take care of the family and other responsibilities. So this is the situation. And as such, lower income families will be the hard hit group.
Thank you, ma'am. There's another question from Lalita Pandey, where she says, I have to ask only one thing. When will men understand women? When will they consider them a human being? That is what they're trying to ask. Lalita Pandey is asking that.
That's why the conclusion is never waste a crisis. So crisis is the best opportunity. And this lockdown had been the best opportunity for men to share the workload at home and to know how much women have been doing for the family. So though they know, they turn a blind eye when it comes to taking responsibilities and everything is expected to be served. So when that changes, at least in the domestic front, there should be equal division of labor. So that men can also experience the share and also the multiple effects. It brings the whole family together emotionally. It creates binding. It's a bonding factor for the family when they all work together. So look at all the positive aspects, and that's the way we are awaiting in the post-COVID situation. Because of this silver lining already in the sky, let us see the break of the dawn.
Thank you, ma'am. There are no more questions, but more of observations, where okay. Sapna Kumari has pointed out that I think a lot has to do with how some men and women are trained to think in one pattern. The blame is upon the way children are raised in a family in India, where majority expect girls to carry on household chores, whereas boys are primarily exempted from it. So when it comes to workload outside home, so to say, the shock of equality is evident among majority. And she adds on, I don't think this has much to do with men understanding women as much as the need for a developing sensitization among all about a considerable share of responsibility at home or outside. Many women are also ignorant towards their concern and sadly contribute in the same. That's my understanding of this issue. Rest our honorable resource person can clarify better. So this is Sapna Kumari's view. And then there is messages from Dr. Veena Singh, Head Department of English, Vasant Kanya Mahavidyalaya, where she has said that this is a truly informative presentation by Dr. Chitra, who has supported with her presentation with research data. Certainly vulnerable marginalized section women and girls have been disturbingly affected by COVID-19. And she also says, congratulations, dear Professor Chitra. Great listening to your enlightening rendition. And Dr. Rajesh Verma is also of the same view. Next in line, I would like to call upon Dr. Niharika Lal, Associate Professor, Department of English, Basant Kanya Mahavidyalaya, to offer formal vote of thanks for the session. Dr. Niharika Lal.
Thank you, Purnima, and good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of Basant Kanya Mahavidyalaya and English for Nation, I am privileged to thank you, ma'am, for your very interesting and data-based talk outlining the detrimental effect of the pandemic on women in various spheres like homes, offices, nutrition. The pandemic has witnessed an upsurge in domestic violence, but as you pointed out, the decrease in complaints may point to the alarming fact that women have become attuned to the violence and accepted it. The work from home situation is increasing the burden of women and some flexibility is required. But there were some very good or heartening points also. And what according to me was very heartening that in some states, it has been reported that men have come forward to accept more responsibility in doing household chores. Stereotype gender roles are in the process of being dismantled. You rightly pointed out that it is the women who keep the societal fabric stitched together. They bear the brunt of the responsibility uncomplainingly and do their utmost to keep the entire world at home and outside intact. We should take, and I agree with you, that we should take advantage of the situation and make the world a better place where there is more balance and harmony between the genders. Thank you once again, ma'am, for your very insightful lecture. And we hope that in future also, we'll be privileged to hear you again. I would like to thank all delegates and participants for making this lecture an enriching experience. Thank you all, and hope to see you all again tomorrow. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am.
Dr. Purnima?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you all. Thank you, Niharika, ma'am. Thank you. Yes. Thank you, Rajesh sir, and everyone around, Veena ma'am.
So,
and all the
participants. Thanks to everyone, Niharika ma'am, Rajesh sir, English for Nation, and to all participants, and to Dr. Purnima.
Thank you.
Thanks, ma'am. And see you.
Thanks. Shall we wind up? Dr. Purnima? Shall we wind up for today?
Yes, ma'am, we can wind up. We can formally wind.
Okay. Then, hope to see you all again tomorrow, and we may close for today.
Yes, ma'am.